In this video, I'm going to talk about agrarian production. So this is the next phase after primitive production. And things get a little more complicated, but it's still, that basic core is still there. All right. So transition to the agrarian form of production. All right, so we had this primitive form of production that we were just looking at previously. Now, with the agrarian form of production, this begins about 10,000 years ago. About 10,000 years ago, hunter-gatherers started settling down and staying in one place. And it's not entirely clear at this point exactly how that process happened, but anthropologists and archaeologists are looking at these remains of these ancient cities or ancient towns, ancient settlements, and they're beginning to learn more and more. So in the coming decades, I think we're going to get some good information on exactly how this happens. But what I gather from some evidence is, you know, this process probably happened in some way. So we know, like, from hunter-gatherers that that still exist today, or at least existed several decades ago. They would be moving around in their tents, and in more current times, it wasn't woolly mammoths that they were hunting, but caribou, like large deer. And there are tribes that are still doing this today in the northernmost portions of like Sweden and Norway. Getting into the Arctic Circle, there's still tribes that do this, and they just they move with the caribou. And and one thing that's characteristic of their culture is from time to time the caribou will descend upon places where there are lots of psychedelic mushrooms. And so and these tend to be areas where the psychedelic mushrooms just regrow every year in a particular spot. So as the caribou go through their migratory routine, you know, then the tribespeople that are following the caribou, they know, okay, we're getting close to the magic mushroom spot. And then, you know, and that becomes part of their culture, where they take that as a kind of holiday and you know, engage in the intoxication and have a little bit of a festival time. And so we imagine that this was happening, you know, all the way back in the Stone Age of hunter-gatherer tribes. And you know, there might be other things that establish just in the course of hunter-gatherer life and the migratory patterns of following herds. There just become to be special spots where it's like, okay, this is where we have our festival. Maybe it's a certain time of the year, you know, whatever the case may be, or maybe there's just something naturally growing there that's like, oh yeah, this is where we get those really good mushrooms, or we get those you know, some kind of fruit, and maybe we can make some wine. But at some point somebody says, you know what, I'm going to stay here, you guys go with the herd, I'm going to stay here, and then next year when you come back, I will have you all set up with the good stuff that's in this place. And then probably these places became sort of sacred and became some kind of, had some sort of religious, you know, indication. We can see, of course, with psychedelic mushrooms, how that would naturally lead to some kind of religious sort of institution you know, if somebody stayed there and cultivated the psychedelic mushrooms, and then they made a building, and then people came there every year, and it's like, all right, this is a celebration. We can see how that just, that would just naturally evolve. So that makes sense. I don't know if that's exactly accurate, but there is some evidence of this. And like I said, in the coming decades, there'll be better information on this. And so we'll see, but that's the story. That's the way I think about it. We get a certain portion of the tribe decides to stay, and this would be a good place maybe where elderly people would end up staying and doing, they'd be provided with a lot of surplus from the hunter-gatherer tribe to sustain them over the long run. And maybe some younger people would stay with them too, in order to do the agricultural kind of labor of, or maybe still doing hunter-gatherer type stuff, but from a home base. And maybe just a portion of the tribe splits off and comes back and resupplies them. You know, there's lots of ways that this could work out. And again, we don't know the details here. There's just little evidence. This is 10,000 years ago. But we know that 10,000 years ago, all of a sudden, this started happening, that people became more sedentary and started staying in one spot. Hunter-gatherers are still out there doing their thing, of course. But these settlements begin to emerge, and we get what then is an agricultural form of production, so that as people begin to settle in these places, they learn, oh, I can plant wheat, and I can harvest that wheat, and then I can make bread. And we do find evidence from this time period of granaries, so silo type buildings. They're not like large silos like we have today, but lower level, but buildings that are specially built to store up grain. And so they had learned at around 10,000 years ago to produce wheat and large enough quantities of it that they're storing it up in storehouses. And so now, for these sedentary people that are not out with the tribe doing the hunter-gatherer thing, their whole form of life is different. But this basic picture still applies, that they need to eat so much, they need to make so much bread in order to eat, and maybe they start to domesticate animals. This is when the domestication of animals happens. So instead of going out and hunting caribou, we start to try to tame caribou. Okay, that's a little difficult because they can jump really high, but little by little you figure out, pigs like to stick around and they don't run off as long as you feed them. And so you start raising pigs, and now you have a meat source that's agricultural based. They're domesticated, and we're not having to run all over the countryside to chase after them. And cows and chickens, and now these species of animals start to show up, and there's more and more of them because human beings are raising them for food. So there's a certain amount of labor that's required to take care of the pigs and the chickens and the cows, and to plant the wheat and to harvest the wheat and all that sort of agricultural lifestyle that's just, being farmers. And there's the necessary weekly labor, but then there's necessary occasional labor. If you're going to make a granary, you have to build it, but you only have to build it, when you have too much grain for where you normally store it already. And so you build a new granary, and then that's it for a long time until you get your production up to a level that you need another one. But you know, there's a necessary level, but then every once in a while, the farming community is going to put in extra work in one way or another, make another granary, really work hard in the fields, or work on breeding better livestock, you know, selectively breeding better pigs and cows and chickens, you're making sure that the biggest and the fattest, you know, mates with the biggest and the fattest, and so you get bigger and fatter children out of them, and you know, that all takes extra labor, variable labor here and there, to get things up to a higher level, and then you have more surplus products. And at a certain point, and it's not clear when this happened, but by the time of feudalism, and so this is when this picture gets fully developed, we're going to have the picture of feudalism. And so this is going to be an explanation of the way that feudal agricultural production operated. And then after this, we'll see how it transitions into capitalism. So here's the big story. So here we need to, and it's getting a little more complicated. So we need to, you know, fill in details and really think about the whole cycle in a more complicated way. But at some point, these settlements that have this agricultural necessary production are starting to produce so much surplus, more than what they need to feed the laborers there, or to feed, you know, the hunter-gatherer tribe as they come in for the big festival. And they start to take produce, the surplus produce, over and above what they need to survive, take that to a market, and then exchange. One small settlement would then go to a marketplace where they are exchanging their surplus produce with other settlements, and they're exchanging you know, pigs for maybe lumber. You know, some settlement is really specializing in making extra lumber so that you can buy from the market. You can trade pigs for lumber, and get some lumber so you can build more granaries. Okay, so. And then you don't have to do the extra labor of producing the lumber yourself, because you have pigs and you need lumber. Now, it's often believed inaccurately that this is entirely a barter process. But as markets begin to appear and these settlements get larger and they become cities, I mean, by 8,000 years ago, these settlements are getting pretty substantial, and by 5,000 years ago, we have mega cities that are very large in scale, with you know, tens of thousands of people living in a city, and people living in apartments and then doing agricultural outside of the city walls and things like that. But it's often and this was taught in high school, and maybe it is still taught today, that these early markets were based on barter. And that's often what people think of in feudalism, that people were just bartering, trading pigs for lumber directly. It doesn't appear that that was ever very prevalent. At certain times, that does emerge, and people do resort to barter, but typically accounts were kept in one way or another in terms of debt, and so you begin to sell your extra surplus produce in some sort of form of money. Maybe it's just a debt in accounts written on paper or on clay tablets. And this is a thing we find, like in ancient Sumeria, is there's a lot of, and writing had developed by this point, about 5,000 years ago. And there's lots of records, and they wrote with a stick that had a triangular shape on the end, and it's called cuneiform. And they would puncture a clay piece of clay while it was wet, and then they would dry that and let it bake in the sun, or maybe bake in ovens. And then they would have like a permanent record. And these records, they had lots and lots of records that we find, and they survive for archaeologists to find because they're made out of clay. And a lot, most of these records are not like literature, you know, history or anything like that. Some of them are like the Epic of Gilgamesh, okay. But most of it is just record keeping. That so-and-so is owed so many pigs, and so-and-so is owed so many pieces of lumber, et cetera, et cetera. And so-and-so owes so-and-so so many bushels of wheat. And so maybe it's not money as we conceive of in our simplified notion of money, but it is debt obligations, and they're not doing barter. Okay, and so that idea that there's just economies of barter doesn't really hold up to historical archaeological scrutiny. So we start to get the emergence at this level of money and accounts and debts. Okay, and this, you know, maybe goes back as far as 8,000 years ago or something like that. We're not quite sure. Again, this story is being filled out right now. So in the coming decades, this will become clearer, I think. but certainly by the time of feudalism, markets were well developed. The concept of money was well developed. You know, during the Roman Empire, there was especially in urban areas, it was a very much a money economy, but based on slave labor. Okay, and of course, we're thinking more of production that occurs out in the countryside, because during the feudal period, people were not living in cities, so the whole imperial order of the Roman Empire disintegrated, as I describe in other videos. And people are largely living in agricultural communities. There are some towns, but the towns are relatively small. And so thinking in terms of England, you know, London is somewhat of a major city, but still very small scale, especially in comparison to ancient Rome. London was a very small city in comparison to Rome of Caesar Augustus. so most people are living out in the countryside and doing agricultural type activity. And so this is agricultural production, although it existed for thousands and thousands of years, and cities had already emerged and fallen apart. Agricultural production is very indicative of feudalism. So things like the cities were evacuated and everybody moved out into the countryside. And they're doing agricultural production like it had been done for thousands and thousands of years. And in feudal society, markets are very important. So you have a landlord, and at the very basic level, you know, so at the lower level of the feudal pyramid structure, you have a landlord who's a vassal to some larger lord, maybe to the king himself, but they have their own fiefdom. They have their own plot of land that they're responsible for, to take stewardship of and to make productive and to make sure that the people who live on the land survive. And of course, these people who live on the land are almost entirely serfs. They're not free to leave the land. They come with the land, they belong to the land, and they can't travel around. They're not at liberty to travel around. And that's really what that word liberty means, is being able to travel about the country. We get then in feudalism the same sort of agricultural production that I've already talked about with, like, let's think of wheat production. You got to do so much plowing of the soil and planting for the next harvest, and then doing the harvest. And of course, from week to week, there's some variable labor involved. And there's occasional labor, like now in the feudal system, the landlord living at the manor estate, something like a castle, a heavily fortified home, and most of the castles in the medieval feudal period are not the giant castles that we envision as castles. They're just like large houses that are heavily fortified. So there, most of this is much smaller scale than we might think, because the population is relatively low in comparison to today, especially today. And these small fiefdoms were very, you know, they didn't have a lot of need for some large castle. It was just, they just needed what was just adequate for their protection and survival. And so a lot of it's a lot smaller scale than you might be thinking. And these fiefdoms would be separated from each other, so there'd be open countryside between the fiefdoms. And so they're kind of isolated small communities. And the serfs never left the fiefdom, you know, and just lived in this very, like, a, you know, 3 mile radius. Now the key feature of serfdom in medieval Europe, this feudalism, the key feature is that a serf within the fiefdom, it was all divided up into rectangular long strips of agricultural land. And from time to time, they would, the lord or one of his administrators would distribute the plots. And so they would shuffle around, and, you know, 1 year Joe might have a particular strip of land, but then the next year they reshuffle it, and he has a totally different part of the fiefdom that he's doing work on. But for each serf, they're given a strip of land to feed their family, and so they'd work their own strip of land, which from time to time was redistributed according to the needs of the community. And that was, they would have enough land so that they could feed their family, and they would just work that just to the level that they could make their family survive. And then they might also, and they would have a small cottage where, of course, they would accumulate stuff like tables and chairs and beds. And they also might, at the back of their cottage, have a little garden where they might do some gardening of some kind of fruit, items that are smaller scale. So there's variable labor involved there to do these special projects in the garden. You know, they might be growing cucumbers or something like that. And but then out in the fields, they're doing like wheat and making wheat for bread. And then at the back of the cottage, maybe they have a cow that they're been able to acquire, and then they milk the cow and get some milk. And this is all just to support the family. just to keep a small family of husband and wife and two or three children living. And that's the necessary consumption. Whatever is needed to keep the family alive. And it's a subsistence level of farming that's taking place. They just produce enough food just to keep themselves alive. And they're only given by the Lord the resources necessary to keep themselves alive. And so for 5 days a week, the serf, the head of the household, the man, is out working in the fields, and maybe one of his sons is helping him at some point. But they're only given enough land to keep them alive. The Lord's not going to give them a bunch of extra surplus land. They're kept at a subsistence level. And of course, if they do get more land or able, you know, they have a good harvest or whatever, that then opens up that whole dynamic gap, and they have more babies and they have more mouths to feed. So it's always just riding at the subsistence level. And agriculture was not very efficient during the feudal period. During the feudal period, little by little, they learn to rotate crops and do a better agriculture. But at first, during the so-called Dark Ages, the production is not very efficient, and there's a lot of soil erosion and things like that. So that's the basic core of the labor for a serf, is to keep their family alive. And that's 5 days a week. Now, on the sixth day, the serf had a smaller strip of land that then he was working for the Lord. And so 1 day a week was owed to the Lord of the manor. And that's when the serf would work a strip of land for, just for the purpose, the Lord owns it, you know, it's for the Lord's house. And so all the produce that the serf works out of that extra strip of land, all that produce goes to the Lord. And that's the surplus, over and above what the serf needs for his family to survive, the necessary consumption. There's that extra strip of land, and the produce that it produces through the labor of the serf, that goes to the landlord. And so the weekly surplus labor, in order to get goods for the lord of the manor, was very clearly defined in feudalism. It's like 5 days a week you're working for your family to survive, and 1 day a week you're working for the Lord. And that whole day that's just for the Lord. And then of course on Sunday they would have church, and that was something, you know, officially a day off, a kind of weekend. But often serfs still had to do labor on that day, but it was a slower day. And the extra labor would be like, or that labor on Sunday would be where they'd take care of like their garden. They wouldn't go out to the fields unless there was some, you know, some special reason why they needed to. Like during harvest season, you know, you gotta really put in maybe some extra, you know, really work on Sunday and do some substantial labor. But in theory, Sunday was supposed to be a day of rest. But in practice, not what we would call a day of rest. So that's this right-hand portion, right, up here. And notice now, in feudalism, this distribution of the surplus, there's no distribution of the surplus back to the serfs. the Lord, for that extra strip of land, that surplus strip of land that the serf is working, it all goes to the Lord. And there's no distributing it back to the serfs. The Lord just keeps it and accumulates and accumulates and accumulates. Now, you can't just store up grain forever. It rots, right? So you are, you're going to take that surplus to the market and you're going to sell it off and then get something that you can use. And of course, at a certain point, the Lord has so much wealth and they're going to market, you know, they start to buy things that are more durable, like chandeliers and silver cups and silverware and things like this. Cooking pot, you know, fancy cooking pots, et cetera, et cetera. And they're accumulating more durable goods, not these agricultural produce that rots and goes bad, that only has a limited lifespan. And of course, they're also accumulating money. Okay. Because money, that's the thing about money, especially when we're thinking in terms of gold coin, that's sort of the typical form of money at this time. Gold is used as money because it doesn't tarnish, it doesn't rust, and it just endures in a nice state over long periods of time. Now, so that one day a week is set aside for the Lord, and that's the variable labor. So that's what Marx likes about this example of feudalism, is it's that variable labor is so well defined. There's that one day working for the Lord, 5 days for the family, and it's clearly defined. Okay, I'm doing extra work. I'm putting in extra work here. I don't need this to feed my family. It's purely for the Lord, and he's keeping all of that surplus produce and accumulating wealth. Now, there's still this necessary occasional labor where, you know, even just to feed the family, you need to have you have to build a bake shop where people are working on baking bread, you know, so you can feed your family. So you're going to, you know, take your produce of grain and you're going to deposit it. And then there's going to be somebody that's making bread. And then you're going to come back and get your portion of bread in order to feed your family. Now, this is all happening without money, okay, because largely without money, because it's a very small community and it's very easy to keep track of, you know, these quantities. It doesn't require money exchange. It's all kind of a very close-knit community. But there is some money exchanging because there are things like pubs, like you go in and drink some beer. And you know, and that is one way that extra surplus grain is taken care of. One way that you can keep grain from rotting in the granary, if you have surplus, is that you can convert it into beer. And then beer has a long shelf life. And that's especially helpful when you're like going through the winter. You can drink the beer made from the grain that was in surplus earlier in the year as it gets colder and you know, your supply of bread is running low. You can have beer in order to, again, consume the necessary calories out of your grain to keep your family alive. So there are things like that. And there are kind of pubs, like small pubs, where people are meeting and drinking and having fun on a weekly basis. And so there is some kind of money economy, even for the serfs, but very minimal. Okay, so you have this occasional necessary labor, like you're going to have to, you know, occasionally build a bake shop, or you're going to, the harvest is, of course, an occasional sort of thing. You're not always harvesting, but when harvest season comes, it's like a lot of extra work. And to harvest the Lord's portions of land, it takes a lot of work. And so lots of serfs are going to be working on a particular strip of land to harvest it real quickly and then move on to the next strip of land. And they're doing this all on behalf of the Lord. And so that's occasional, both to feed the family and to feed the Lord. But then there's this concept called corvée. And corvée is just the Lord could just at any time say, hey, I'm calling a corvée. You got to, everybody has to chip in and do this thing, that this project that I have going on. And corvée might be to build out a portion of the Lord's house, castle. So the Lord can just call corvée. And so for a few weeks, they're going to build out a new room. And the Lord has that at their discretion. They're able to do that. Another use of corvée might be to you know, go out into the countryside, into the woods, and gather wood, to you know, gather timber, raw materials, in order for them to bring back to the manor and to have it go into manufacturing lumber. The Lord can just call corvée, and it's like, okay, we're going to go chop down some trees this day. So everybody show up early in the morning. We're going to go out. We're going to get so many trees. And then when you guys get back, I'll have a nice banquet for you. But I need this done. And that was his right to just call on this extra labor. So this is the variable labor in terms of occasional labor, corvée. And it was a legal concept. And so again, it's a nice model to think about these concepts for Marx, because everything is just so clearly defined in feudalism. Corvée is this variable occasional labor. The working of the extra strip of land is the weekly variable labor. It's like graphic. It's like you can see it in the landscape, and you can see it in the legal concepts, and in the daily and weekly, yearly routine of the serf's life. There's these variations in labor that are very clearly defined and obligated, all in order to serve the Lord. Okay, so the Lord is taking all the surplus. And then as the Lord accumulates more surplus, they're going to market. So markets are a big part of the feudal system. And again, this is often said that it's a barter market, but that's not accurate. So there's a money, there's a money economy, especially around markets. But on the manor, there's a lot more barter going on. Now, when you take surplus produce to market, in the market, everything is considered a commodity. So you have so many bushels of grain. That's the same as anybody else's bushels of grain. It's just measured out in certain quantities, and there's a standardization. And so if I come to market and I need, you know, 5 bushels of grain, I'm going to buy it from whoever has it, because it's all basically the same. They're just commodities. They're commodified. And we're not thinking of them in terms of special qualities or craftsmanship. It's just there's a standard way of producing it, a standard way of packaging it. You bring it to market, somebody buys what they're looking for. And this is generally the case about markets, even to this day, right? So everything in the marketplace is commodified. And so this commodification through the market is very, very important for understanding Marxism. So we've got to make sure that we really understand commodities. You know, and if it's like you're producing bricks, you know, so maybe the Lord is like, oh, okay, we'll set up a brick shop and then I can take those bricks to market. You know, there's a standardization and a way that everything is commodified and packaged in a standardized way so that, you know, the bricks I buy this year are going to be similar, very similar to the bricks I buy next year. You know, I don't want all kinds of weird stuff going on. You want things commodified and packaged in a standardized way. And what happens is those commodities, when they're taken to the marketplace, they're converted into the form of money. And then the money is fed back into the market and converted into the reproduction of the means of production. So now, if I'm the lord of the manor, I don't have to have my serfs do corvée in order to produce lumber, right? To go out into the woods and chop down trees. I can just buy the lumber at the marketplace using the money that I got from selling my surplus grain. And then I can use that money to buy lumber. And now I've reproduced, you know, the means of production, like a granary or some other workshop that I have going on the manor, that then makes the manor all that more efficient. And I didn't have to employ corvée. I could just buy what I needed from the market. So the market becomes very convenient. And it took a while during, and this is part of the so-called dark ages, is markets weren't really functioning. But by the time of high feudalism, when the feudal order got in place, you know, with Charlemagne comes in and gets things ordered, and then in the subsequent centuries, markets become really well developed in Europe. And I should mention too that with the cathedrals, the cathedrals were often used as marketplaces, so much so that even like market exchanges are taking place inside of the sanctuary. So you have like people selling vegetables and bread and you know, maybe even larger scale things inside of the building. You know, so the buildings were arranged very differently than they are today, where there were like standing halls and not so much seating, you know, so it was used as a kind of community center. And markets originally sprung up around cathedrals and either outside or even indoors at certain points. And that's, you know, part of the reason why cathedrals became these grand structures, is the cathedral was really a symbol of the marketplace, of the success of a market. You know, as the market surrounding the cathedral got bigger, the cathedral got bigger and taller and become more of an icon. There's a deep economic feature of the grand scale of a cathedral. The surplus wealth of the entire community, or like the king of a large fiefdom like Paris, it becomes a way of aggrandizing the king by building a very large cathedral structure, but it also had this community element. It was a social, it was an expression of social relationships. It aggrandized the king, but it also helped lower level landlords and even the population at large to have a marketplace where, you know, this more sophisticated level of existence was operating. Okay, so now we have partial reproduction of the means of production through the marketplace, and partial reproduction of the means of production still through you know, harvesting the wheat for the Lord on a yearly or otherwise occasional basis and doing things like that. And still, you know, the Lord would invoke corvée, but the burden of corvée is greatly reduced by the existence of a well-functioning marketplace. So this makes life a lot easier. Okay, and this is, now we've got the feudal order in place. Of course, one aspect that Marx doesn't talk about and is often overlooked is that now, you know, if I'm buying lumber from the marketplace, okay, I'm not having my serfs go out on corvée to chop down trees. So I'm not taking trees from the ecology through there. But when I buy the lumber at the marketplace, I'm still taking raw materials out of the ecology. It's just distant from me. I don't see it. And this is kind of a hidden cost. There's this hidden ecological impact that the market obscures. And that, of course, is very important for us now because we are so much a market-based society that we don't see the ecological impact that we're making. In feudal times, especially before markets are well developed, the Lord would see, okay, we're chopping down trees. I can see that there's a patch of trees missing, and you are very closely connected, and the serfs are connected to the way in which the ecology is being impacted. And there's a limit to how much you can exploit the ecology within your fiefdom. With the marketplace, that all becomes obscured, and it almost becomes thinkable that there is no limit to the ecology. And of course, this is a big problem in our day because we're reaching the limit of the ecology, but we are blinded to the impact we're making on the ecology for many centuries because of the way the market obscures the ecological impact. So this is that ecological, political ecology that I'm trying to develop. and it's interesting to think of it in these Marxist terms. Okay. Now, one thing that the market introduces, okay, you have surplus is converted into commodities. And at a certain point, the Lord is taking the surplus from the serfs and not distributing it back to them, but accumulating it. And he begins to think of the production that the serfs are doing purely in terms of commodity. And a commodity, which I want to define at this point, a commodity is something that's produced purely for the purpose of exchange. So the Lord begins to think in terms of commodity, like so many bushels of grain, because I'm going to take that to the market. And the only reason I'm having the serfs produce this is not for my consumption, but just to take it to the marketplace. And so part of the commodification process is that you begin to think of produce, the products of labor, you begin to think of the products of labor as purely something to get rid of in order to exchange it for money, or maybe, you know, exchange it for lumber. In your head, you're thinking, I need so many bushels of grain to get lumber, but it operates through the exchange of money. But the original grain, you have no intention of eating it. There's just, you're not thinking of it as something that you eat. You're only thinking of it as something to get rid of in order to get money. That's what a commodity is. It's produced. You begin to think of the very production just as something that you don't need and that you're going to exchange for something that you do need. And this is like, you know, ultimately in capitalism, this is the way everything is thought of. Okay, but this is where commodification begins, especially coming out of the disorder of the fall of the Roman Empire in Western Europe, and then the emergence of feudalism. This is all historically taking place, and it's so clear when you look at the history here that there's this process of commodification. Now, commodification had existed before this in the Roman Empire and everything, okay. But what's nice about the example of feudalism is you have this period of disorder and very basic agricultural societies without much market activity taking place, and then markets establish themselves, and the commodification is very apparent, where you have a period of non-commodification and going into a period of a commodification. And we should notice too that not only the things that you sell at the market are thought of in terms of commodities, but the things that you buy at the market are thought of as commodities that somebody else brought to get rid of. And so you're purchasing raw materials, equipment, and facilities, you know, as a commodity. And again, it's standardized, so you know what you're going to the market to get. You know it's going to be there because there's this commodification process. And that's going to be very important for understanding the Marxist analysis of capitalism. Okay. And so now there's partial reproduction of the means of production through the market, but a lot of the surplus commodities are converted into money and then just come back in the form of money to the Lord. And so the Lord starts to accumulate money wealth. And this accumulation of money wealth is really sowing the seeds for the destruction of feudalism. So feudalism has an inherent contradiction as the Lord accumulates more wealth. It begins to strengthen this money economy, but the whole feudal way of life is based on agricultural production with very little money exchange. And we, in the history of emerging out of that rudimentary feudalism to high feudalism, you have a period where it's not a money-based economy, to where it starts to produce money accumulation in the lords, and then it goes beyond that and becomes, as feudalism disintegrates, almost purely money-based economy, where the whole prestige of the landlord who owns land, that was their wealth, was really the land. As money becomes the measure of wealth, then landlords aren't that wealthy in comparison to like bankers. Okay, so it's feudalism is sowing the seeds of its own demise. And so we want to notice some interesting things here. The market is a market of commodities. Okay, so this commodification. And now, this is an important concept, is that money, you know, we're thinking in terms of like gold coin, money is the universal commodity. Because when I go to the marketplace, I need certain commodities. And I may need lumber, but somebody else needs grain. And so what I'm bringing to market as a commodity isn't something that everybody needs, but I'm going to find the person who needs it. But everybody needs money. And money is the universal commodity. Everybody needs that commodity. And so money is the universal commodity. And as commodification, you know, takes place, a key feature is money. And money is the universal commodity. Okay. And then we get this interesting series of market exchange. You have commodity one, so that's C1. In my example that I've been using, it's commodity one is the grain that I bring to the market. It's converted into money, so I get money for the grain, and then I take that money and I convert it into commodity number two, and commodity number two will be lumber. So in the way that Marx talks about this, he thinks of it as like a morphing process where the grain comes into the market, it's morphed into money, and then the money morphs into lumber. And if you think of that visually as grain coming into the market, it gets morphed into money, and then the money gets morphed into lumber. It's a morphological process. And that's very much the way that he thought of it. Now, the money that I get for the grain is its exchange value. So money becomes a very specific measure of exchange value. Remember when I was talking about like the axe that I built, that I made extra, and then I gave my old one away to my friend. There's always in the background some notion of exchange value, but once you have a market and of course that kind of gift giving and barter gift giving, it would be happening in the feudal times amongst serfs themselves because they had very little money. But they would still be thinking, okay, Joe gave me an axe, I need to give him something that's kind of similar. And so there, in the background, there's that notion of exchange value. But when you're in the marketplace, the exchange value is the price. It's the money the grain morphs into money, and the money is a measure of the exchange value, the price that you can get. And that's different from the use value. So the grain that I'm bringing to market actually doesn't have any use value for me. It only, as a commodity, its only value is its exchange value. Its only value for me, because it's extra and I have no use for it, its only value is the money that I can get for it. But lumber, because I don't have enough lumber, that has a use value for me, because I'm gonna use it to build out my house or build a new granary or whatever the case may be. So that distinction between exchange value and use value is very important. Something that is often overlooked in classic economics, Marx was deriving a lot of his thinking. He just went along with certain assumptions of classic economics, including the work of Adam Smith and David Ricardo. These were the two big guys that he drew from. And they often overlook this distinction. So he really emphasized this. Not that they entirely overlooked it, but Marx wants to emphasize this much more strongly. And now, whether we're thinking in terms of exchange value or use value, what is the source of the value? Where does the value come from? The value comes from the labor. And this is called the labor theory of value. And Adam Smith and David Ricardo both believed in this. That's like the foundation of their economic theory, is the labor theory of value. So Marx did not make this up. He's just assuming, okay, Adam Smith, David Ricardo, these are big dogs in economics and did a lot of really good work, and he admires their work. And at the heart of it is a labor theory of value, that all value, whether it's thought of in terms of exchange value for commodities or in terms of use value for things that you're buying from the market, the ultimate source of the value, what you're willing to pay for it, the ultimate source of the value is the labor that was used to produce the commodity. And Marx wants to emphasize the implications, the social implications that this has. Okay. And then there's another interesting series where if you're in the marketplace, and let's say you're just like a, you're running like a supply shop, you're like a merchant operating in the market, there's a different series. You use, as a merchant, you use your money that you've accumulated to buy commodity X. Let's say you use your money to buy some lumber, and then you take possession of that lumber, and then somebody comes to buy that lumber and you convert it back to money. So here we have the morphing process of money becomes lumber, and then lumber becomes money. So you go from money to lumber, morphs into lumber, and then the lumber morphs into money. And that's the activity from the perspective of the merchant in the marketplace. But this isn't exactly what the merchant is into. The merchant doesn't want to just convert money into lumber and then convert it back to money, because then he just ends up with the same money. The whole point of being a merchant is to convert a certain amount of money into lumber and then convert that lumber into more money, the original amount of money plus a difference of money. So this delta is a difference in money, some extra, some surplus. So you're taking money, and through the market exchange, you're taking money and making money with a surplus of money. So you get money converted into money with a little bit extra. And that's really what the merchant is doing in the marketplace, buying low and selling high. But the holy grail of the marketplace is just to take money and make more money directly from money. You take money and you morph it into the original money with a little bit of extra. And that's really the holy grail. That's really what everybody ultimately wants, is just to make money into more money. And of course, the way that you do that is through usury, right? So charging of interest, and that's the role of the banker. But again, as we get into money just becoming more money, this changes the whole structure of feudal society, and that's one of the key drivers that drives us into capitalism. All right. And we have this fundamental question: the distribution of the surplus value that originates from the labor of the worker gets converted into money and accumulated more and more in the form of money in the hand of the landlord or the banker or the merchant in the marketplace, and none of it's getting distributed back to the laborers, the serfs themselves. That's very clear in feudalism, that the serfs are getting the wrong end of the stick. And that is that. So here we have agrarian production. And I'll leave it at that, and then we'll move into burger production. So that's a phase of production that's before capitalism. All right, bye-bye.